Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry we're a little bit late. The EB did run on. I'm going to do a little bit like we did yesterday. As I promised many of you, we got Dr. Budgett along today, the medical director of the IOC, to give you a kind of a roundup of where we are in terms of the whole pre-testing for Rio, which is now just about reaching its end. So we thought it would be a good idea to give you a kind of a full rundown. And I think, I don't know if you have them yet, but I think there are sheets which we can distribute to people, which will give you the full rundown, numbers, even names. So without further ado, let me pass over to Dr. Budgett, and then we'll come back for the other topics after that. So Dr. Budgett, over to you.
Thank you very much, Mark. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm very pleased to be able to give you an update on the reanalysis program from Beijing and London. As you know, it's a really top priority for the IOC. It's one of our main ways of protecting the clean athlete in our fight against doping in sport, and it's that's shown in Agenda 2020. So this is a very important part of Agenda 2020 and of the activities of the IOC. And as you'll see in the sheets as they come around, this all started back in August 2015. Working with WADA, with a number of national anti-doping organizations to get the intelligence we needed for the reanalysis program. And it's resulted, as you may know, in 41 athletes who were eligible for the Rio Games being sanctioned. And the successful results are really due to the improved methods that have been developed since 2012, and they came into action in 2013. There was some reanalysis done in 2009, immediately after the Beijing Games, and in 2015, and they resulted in five seropositives in 2009, which you may remember, and there was one EPO-positive 2015, but the vast majority of reanalysis has been done this year. And you may remember in July, we released the number of 98, and there were 98 adverse analytical findings in July. Since that time, the program has continued. It's an ongoing program, and particularly with a number of bump-up athletes and with others for whom we have intelligence. So there's three more adverse analytical findings, bringing the total number to 101. And I can assure you there will be many more to come in the future because the program is continuing. In the coming weeks and months, we should expect more from London. But of course, because of the statute limitations, the analysis in Beijing is finished. We've been cooperating closely, as I said, with WADA, with the international federations, with national anti-doping organizations, and with the McLaren team. And this is an example of the anti-doping community working together, because without us working together, we couldn't have done such an effective and intelligent test distribution plan of the reanalysis. And a number of medals have been reallocated. The real aim of doing this is, firstly, as a deterrence, so that athletes who are thinking of cheating will realize now that, be it 4 years, be it 6 years, be it eight, and in the future 10 years because of the new code, they could still be caught, and they're very likely to be caught, so they need to watch out. And also, for the sake of the clean athletes, so that as well as being people being put off doping, those athletes who were denied their medals, denied their placings at the games, have a chance, albeit much later, of receiving those medals. So if you look at the headline figures, Beijing, if you add up the total since 2008, including those Sierra ones in 2009, there's been 1,053 reanalyses. And so far, 49 athletes have been sanctioned. Obviously, there's more adverse analytical findings, but we can only give you the details of the 49. And they're all detailed by name in the sheet you've been given. And you can also see the statistics detailed of the number of athletes per sport, per country, related to the number of entrants, the number of athletes that country had at the Games. And then London, 492 samples have so far been reanalyzed, but as I say, that is very much an ongoing program, so that figure will change week by week. And so far, 30 have been sanctioned, so those are the 30 we're able to give you details about. A few points to make. The first is that the amount of urine is actually limited, because when an athlete goes to doping control, I'm sure you all know the international standards backwards, but you have to produce 60 mils for the A bottle and 30 mils for the B bottle, so it's a minimum of 90 mils. Obviously, a lot of that A sample is used at the time of analysis, and sometimes we're lucky and there's nearly 30 mils left. Other times, there might be hardly any 5 mils or less. So what we can do with the sample does depend on how much urine is remaining. And we have to prioritize when we will reanalyze that sample. So if there is good intelligence from all these cooperators I was talking about, that a group of athletes are at high risk of being positive for a particular substance, and we have a new test for that substance, then it makes sense to do that testing earlier. And that is the situation we're in with London. Obviously, when we're coming to the end of the period, then you do a lot more broad testing, and we've tested 89 National Olympic athletes from 89 National Olympic committees in 16 sports through this program. So it's a widespread program targeting all the countries where there are successful Olympians. So it's not just those for which you see adverse finding, it's lots of other countries as well. But because one of the aspects of doping control is deterrence, and it's very important to keep things unpredictable to maximize that deterrence, we don't give you the exact test distribution plan, but we can give you an indication of exactly how we choose the samples to test, and reassure you that we do this very much in conjunction with the International Federations and the World Anti-Doping Agency. Obviously, it would be best to test those athletes immediately, the most effective deterrence is one where the sanction happens immediately. But it is better to have a sanction at some point, albeit delayed, and also better for the clean athletes I mentioned earlier. So I think the final thing to say is if an athlete's cheating now, they need to be worried, particularly if they're cheating at the games, where we do keep the samples. And more anti-doping organizations are retaining samples. So I think in the future, this is a very important tool in the fight against doping in sport. We are, I'm glad to say, leading the way in the IOC, but it's not just us, it's us working with the international federations, with WADA, with the McLaren team, with the NADOs, to produce the result you see today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Budgett. And just tell us, it's now 10 years, but it was 8 years. Can you tell us which
yeah, code? There was a new code, as I'm sure you know, it came out in January 2015. So any samples taken since January 2015 have a statute of limitations, which is 10 years. We'd hope that would be retroactive, but because of the rules of the IOC, that it's actually clear that it's 8 years for anything before, any Olympic Games anyway, before January 2015.
Thank you very much. Okay, happy to take questions on that particular topic, and let's start with Carlos Groman there from Reuters.
When do you see the London retesting completed?
Just before the Olympics in Tokyo.
Thanks, Callum Murray from SportCal. Dr. Budgett, looking at the results by country, there's a pretty obvious bias towards countries from Eastern Europe. Do you have any observations about why that should be and how that can be addressed?
Well, I mean, you can speculate about the reasons for that. And obviously, many athletes there must have been taking these substances, which were mostly the classical anabolic steroids. And it's known that one of the most effective new tests we've had since 2013 is the long-term metabolite test. So rather than detecting stanazolol, turinabol, substances like that for a few days, it's now a few weeks. And that, I think, has made the big difference. As to why those particular countries were using those particular substances, I think that would be speculation.
Thank you, Steve Wilson from AP. Dr. Budgett, can you talk about any retesting of samples from Vancouver, whether they've been started, they've done, any results from that? And what is the status of retests from Sochi, if any, that you're involved with? Thank you.
Well, first of all, to deal with Vancouver, obviously the statute of limitations will run out in February 2018, so that will be our priority for 2017. And we will work again with the IAFs, with WADA, and with NADOs to make sure we have the most intelligent plan of reanalysis. There have been a number of reanalyses so far, but no adverse analytical findings. And they were targeted because there was particular intelligence from international federations, but not a large number. So the very large number will be next year. Oh, and for Sochi samples, as you know, McLaren has been investigating the Sochi samples, and we've been working very closely with him. So about half the samples are actually in London at the moment. They will be coming back to Lausanne, and we will conduct forensic examination on those and all the ones we still have, and also a reanalysis. There were a number of blood samples, nearly 60 blood samples from Sochi on Russian athletes, and those have already been reanalyzed, particularly for the anabolic agents, which we were concerned about, but there were no adverse analytical findings.
Yeah. Mark.
Mark Bisson around the rings. Given what's happened with Beijing and London, are you approaching Rio in a different frame of mind? Are you doing things differently, with greater scrutiny, with different methods to root out the cheats who did cheat in Rio?
Well, obviously we will use the best available tests there are at the time. And we're lucky with the Olympics that we do get the best scientists in the world coming to help at the laboratory at the Games. And so I think we'd be confident that the science behind the analysis is state of the art, and was state of the art in Rio. And it was one of the great success stories of the Games in Rio was the laboratory in the end. What I can say is that the nearly 5,000 samples collected in Rio are now all in Lausanne. So they will be kept for the 10 years, and we will use exactly the same process of reanalysis if there is good intelligence, if there is a new test that comes along. I mean, we have hopes there'll be better tests for erythropoietin, maybe for growth hormone, maybe for other substances. So as the scientists develop better tests, then will be the time to look at the samples we've got, look at the athletes who are at risk, and decide which samples should be tested, working all the time with WADA, with the international federations, and with NADOs.
Yeah, Nick Butler, and then Wakaka.
Thanks, Nick Butler, Insight for Games. Three quick things. Any progress on maturing 2006 retests, following on from Steve's question? Secondly, there's a section in here about plans to develop a test for EPO and other substances. How confident are you that will be developed for the London samples, and do you think that could have an impact? And lastly, as you mentioned Rio, you said the laboratory had been a big success. Other elements of the testing program clearly weren't a success, the logistical aspects with the organizing committee. What will you do to make sure that doesn't happen again in Tokyo? And will there be any further studies and reports as to what happened in Rio to assess if it affected the overall anti-doping operation at all? Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, I can't say anything about 2006, so sound like a broken record there. For erythropoietin, I think I would say I'm hopeful. But there is absolutely, with science and these sort of things, there's absolutely no guarantee. I think the route it would come from would be this whole interest in the area of omics, so genomics or proteomics or metabolomics. So looking at the effect of taking a substance on the way your genes are expressed or the way your metabolism is expressed, and that effect can last for a long time. So you get dozens of genes affected when you take some erythropoietin. And what you have to do is tease out the ones that are uniquely changed, as opposed to the ones that are changed if you go to altitude, or you eat some food, or you go training hard, etc. So our genes, the expression of our genes is changing all the time. And so you're looking at the effect of the substance, almost a secondary marker of the taking of that substance. So there is some hope there, but I think it's hopeful. But we don't know from what angle tests will come. I don't think anyone predicted the long-term metabolite test would be so successful 5 years ago. And then for the Rio testing, obviously there were challenges. We all know there were challenges in Rio with the logistics, with the workforce. I had to pay tribute to the specific workforce in doping control, particularly the doping control officers from all over the world and in Rio, who did an incredible job. And they worked amazingly hard to make sure that the samples were collected. We weren't aiming for numbers. We didn't publicize any numbers beforehand. Obviously, we didn't get quite to the numbers we wanted, but it was still more tests than is done in any other event in such a short time since London. So there are a lot of tests done in Rio, and the good thing is they all the integrity of those tests was maintained. So the adverse findings we got were valid, and when it comes to testing in the future for the reanalysis, that'll be valid as well. And obviously, now the whole process of transporting the samples to Lausanne is the IOC and others have learnt from the past, so it's getting better and better. So the whole logistics of the reanalysis program, I think, will be easier for Rio than it's been for any previous games, thanks to that experience.
Yes, sorry, Wakako. Apologies. Yeah, over here, Wakako.
Thank you, Dr. Budgett. Wakako Yuki from Yomiuri Shimbun. Two questions. One is, those retesting from Beijing, London, especially when you're looking at those substances that Russian athletes were tested positive, usually it tend to be very similar or the same substance or the same sets of substance I noted. Do you think yourself that this could be one of the evidence, possible evidence that the systematic doping has been going on from as long as I'm in Beijing onwards? Second part, if I may take your, have your response on cyber attack to Adams, and which was targeting IOC created account. What is your wisdom for the future that these could be prevented? Thank you.
On the first question about the athletes being found with similar substances, I think it's difficult to draw. I mean, you can speculate that will be one reason, in that there's some systematic doping going on, groups of athletes all under the same coach or same management taking the same substance, or it might be that the athletes who are cheating talk to each other and they know these things work and they work out a way of the of taking micro doses. So at the regime at the time, they weren't detectable, but of course they are now. But it's really speculation as to it adds some substance to the debate about what was behind the adverse findings, but it doesn't actually tell us exactly what went on. And I'm sorry, I think I'm the wrong person to talk about cyber attacks. Obviously, I think it's really unfortunate, and the medical side of me as a doctor thinks it's outrageous that the private medical details of these athletes is published on the web, because these are innocent athletes. They haven't done any offence. There's really no excuse for publishing their medical details, and I think it's extremely unfortunate for the whole system.
Thanks again. Two things about why do you expect so many more tests, positive findings, adverse findings from London, from the London Games, and how many more potentially could there be? And secondly, the fact that most of these cases, you know, involve those classical steroids that you mentioned so far, does that mean that, it's possible that, many athletes got away with the designer steroids, which were not, which you couldn't catch? So maybe you're only catching the old timers, but not the more advanced dopers.
It's, the second one is quite a scientific question, and I'm not absolutely sure whether it's true that our tests for the designer steroids are no better than our tests for these classical steroids and the long-term metabolites. Certainly, these classical anabolic agents work well for the athletes, and so that's why they use them, because they are convinced they work. Even in the small doses, they use them. And why do I expect more positives? I suppose it's really extrapolation. I'm reasonably comfortable that we weren't going to get any significant number of more positives in Beijing, because the last few athletes, the last hundreds of athletes we tested, there were no positives. But we're still getting positives from the intelligent targeting of samples from London. So that does suggest that that will continue.
Just to clarify, Dr. Budgett, are you saying you think there will be more than Beijing, or you just meant that there will be more?
Not more. I can't. That would be total conjecture, and it might very easily be less. So we might get 5 more, we might get 10 more, we might get 20 more. I just don't know at this point. Yeah. And it depends at what point we'll get some more. Yeah.
Back to Rio. Do you have a sense that Rio was the cleanest games on record? Do you have a feeling that it could be, or do you think we could have problems down the line with huge waves of positives coming in next year and in the next 3 years, building up to Tokyo?
Yes, it's a really interesting question. I think it's just pure speculation. I mean, it's interesting that there's a similar number of adverse findings at the games themselves as the previous two games. And so that doesn't really give us any clue. I might hope that all the publicity around the reanalysis program and the thought in these athletes' head that my samples are going to be kept, I know the IOC are going to keep them, would mean that athletes actually going to the games were cleaner than ever. Of course, the most important thing is what athletes are doing in the 3 or 4 years between the games. So that's the other whole really important thing we need to tackle, and we're doing that. And we did that in the 6 months leading up to Rio, working with WADA, working with NADOs to enhance the testing leading into the games. There's still a long way to go. And this is the whole idea behind the independent testing authority, is to raise the both the efficiency and the effectiveness of testing through the whole time and not just at the games.
Good evening, Eric Bernaudeau, Agence France Presse. As half of these cases come from weightlifting, as there will be a review of the Olympic program in 2017, do you think weightlifting is at risk of being expelled from the Olympic program?
It's not really my place to answer that, but I suppose every sport is at risk, and I'd also would say that weightlifting have got a good program in place at the moment. So it's a judgment as to the what went on in the past and what weightlifting as a sport are doing now.
Nick.
Thanks, Nick, again. On the slide side, International Judo Federation President Marius Fieser of the weekend has called for athletes taking TUEs to be banned from competition for the time the effects of them are in their body. What's your impressions on that? And do you think the TUE system needs any reform?
I disagree. I was going to say something stronger than that, but I certainly disagree. Because obviously it's someone who's diabetic on insulin, and certainly one of the most famous rowers in the United Kingdom, I rowed with back in 1984, Steve Redgrave, is a diabetic on insulin. To deny him the opportunity to compete in his sport is simply not appropriate. And the whole point of therapeutic use exemptions is that it enables an athlete to be treated for a condition so they can get back to the level they would be if they didn't have that illness. And so I agree, it is a judgment in some cases, but it's a fair judgment. And it's a very small proportion of athletes who have therapeutic use exemptions, about 1% of athletes at the games. So it's not a big issue. And all the substances that have been taken are not the same as the ones we're finding. They're not the anabolic steroids, they're not erythropoietin. So I think it's very important that we support athletes who have conditions that need treatment. It would be unethical to deny athletes treatment when they need it. So it's good that we have a system in place that allows them to take the substances they need safely and fairly.
Okay, I think, Dr. Budgett, I think that was certainly interesting for me and education for me. So thank you very much indeed. Very, very useful And we will attempt to keep you updated on the testing program as it continues, because it basically is a non-stop program.
Correct.
So thank you very much, Dr. Budgett. And I will now, as briefly as I can, I'm going to run through a quick rundown of what happened for the rest of the day today. So looking at my sheet, so as you probably know, mainly today was taken up by organizing committee reports. So we started with Rio 2016, and Carlos Nussmann was here. They presented their plans. They obviously winding down as an organization. And they provided some very interesting data. And I know you're very keen to have data on their games, which is data that some of it was new to me and very interesting for you, I'm sure. So for example, Metro Line 4, which was, as you know, built as part of the games, is now carrying 200,000 passengers a day. The three BRT lines, the bus rapid transport lines, which were also put in place using the games as a platform to improve public transport in the city, they're now carrying 450,000 passengers a day. They presented a report by Ernst & Young. The economic impact of the games was 21 and two-thirds billion US dollars of investment. 21.66 billion US dollars of direct and indirect investment. Airbnb, a report from Airbnb that karaoke has made $100 million from renting their homes during the games, which is quite a good figure. 1.79 million jobs, short and medium mainly, but also long term, but 1.7 million jobs were created during the games. And the important tourism impact, another report which you may have seen, 1.2 million visitors during the Rio Olympic Games, spending $304 million. Happy to give you any more information on those stories, because I know you're all very keen on reporting the good news aspect of the Rio Olympic Games. Pyeongchang also gave a report, 428 days to go. President Lee presented the status of the games, preparations obviously for the next, as the next host city, reported on the large number of activities taking place, world press briefing, world broadcaster meeting, chef de mission, 1 year to go, and of course the 24 test events that we'll see over this season coming up. President Bak congratulated Lee on his presidency and gave the full support of the IOC to the Olympic Winter Games Pyeongchang 2018. Tokyo also reported, following the Rio debrief, which was held in Tokyo, and the third Coordination Commission meeting in Tokyo 2020 last week, as well as updating the EB on operational matters, the Tokyo delegation spoke about the success of their participation in the Rio Games. Particularly the handover segment at the end of the closing ceremony, and they also presented a video of the homecoming parade of their 87 medalists from Rio, which attracted 800,000 people onto the streets of Tokyo. The EB agreed to the following venue proposals from Tokyo 2020 organisers concerning the five sports that had events approved during the session in Rio. Baseball, softball competitions will be held in the Yokohama Stadium in the Kanagawa Prefecture. Karate will take place in the Nippon Budokan, which is already hosting judo in 2020. Skateboarding and sport climbing will be hosted at the Aomi Urban Sports Venue, with the spectacular location of Tokyo Bay as a backdrop. And finally, surfing will be located in Surigasaki Beach. Sorry, apologies for my pronunciation to my Japanese friends, which is situated at the southern end of the Kujukuri Beach in Chiba Prefecture. The beach, it says, is a popular surfing destination. Beijing was the other organizing committee to present. Impressive report from 2020. I think the executive board were very impressed by the progress being made. The OCOG is taking shape, now got 176 staff, 50 of whom are on the Rio Observers Program, making a great deal of development in sport in China, winter sport. One figure shared by the Beijing organisers was last winter the number of residents practising winter sports in Beijing and Zhangjiakou alone increased by 30%, reaching 6.8 million people. So if you doubt that there's an interest in winter sports in the region, 6.8 million Chinese probably would like to disagree with you. And the executive board congratulated the Beijing team on their work. I think there was also a figure that there are now something like 570 ski facilities in China, which again is a figure that you don't really kind of expect. Something like 570, I think, or more than 550 anyway. 536, thank you, Robert. So that was Beijing 2020's report. And then just very quickly to tell you that we also had a presentation of the IOC's new sustainability strategy, which was accepted today and its implementation of parts of Olympic Agenda 2020. And that looks at three areas of responsibility: the IOC as an organization, the IOC as the owner and of the Olympic Games, and the IOC as the leader of the Olympic movement. Those three areas were looked at. So there we go. That's a quick rundown of what was discussed today. We also, by the way, had a report from Buenos Aires Youth Olympic Games Organising Committee as well, and Lausanne too. So thank you very much. Ready to take any questions that there may be, or you may all be full up already with drugs-related information. Yes, Mark.
On Tokyo 2020, I know that the Yoshihiro Mori and his team talked about the budget, this 20 million, 20 billion ceiling, or this upper limit, as they call it. What discussions were held around that, and what was the message from the IOC to Tokyo 2020?
That is, as you say, it's a ceiling, meaning that's not a figure, and it's certainly not a figure that the IOC recognises or sees where it comes from. And we gave the very strong opinion advice that they can and will save more money, particularly on that 20 billion figure, which seems to come we know not where from, really. It's a ceiling, but certainly not a figure that we recognise.
I just ask about your statement earlier on the McLaren report. You said your provisional measures are still in place. The most significant of those for now seems to be the one about freezing preparations for winter events. US athletes came out yesterday and said they were considering boycotting the bobsleigh world championships in February. Should that event be stripped from Russia now? What's the IOC response? And also, there seems to be a contradiction, because you gave permission for the IBU to award their world championships to Russia for 2021. So does that decision still stand? Thank you.
Yeah, no, and it is a difficult judgment. And obviously to say also that each individual federation is independent, but the call from the IOC was that those events that were not already planned and that would not have significant budgetary effects on the federations, as far as I remember, was the call. So it is an indicative demand that that's what we would like to see. As for the American athletes, they are independent athletes and able to express their opinion. As it stands, that event was planned beforehand and doesn't contravene the IOC's call, as far as I understand. Yes.
Thank you. Question from CCTV China. I'm wondering, may I have more details on today's Beijing report? Who gave the report, and what's the reaction and the comments from the executive board members? Thank you.
What I would say is it was very, very, very positively received. And as I said, I think they've made the executive board felt that they've made huge progress in a short time, very well organised. I think for kind of the details of what was said, I would direct you to Robert Roxburgh in the front here, who was also in the meeting and was probably more attentive than I was during that actual presentation. But he will be able to give you a little bit more detail, Robert, I think. No. at the end of the meeting. Yes, at the back there.
Simply to follow up on Nick's question regarding the IBSF World Championships in February, the guidance issued in July, on July 19th, had said that the IOC asked winter federations to freeze their preparations for major events in Russia, such as World Championships, World Cups, or other major international competitions, and to actively look for alternative organizers. Did the IOC in any way privately communicate with the IBSF in giving counsel and getting a sense of whether alternatives were considered?
On that, it won't surprise you to know that I don't know whether we were in contact with the Federation to ask them to actively look for, but what is clear is that in our declaration we made it clear we wanted them to actively look and we encouraged them to actively look. I can't tell you whether the sports director, not here anyway, I can't tell you whether the sports director spoke to the Federation or not.
It seems to be understanding that the Federation did not solicit other alternatives. Is the IOC disappointed in that? That recommendation was not followed?
I wouldn't know the detail of the case to be able to kind of give you an answer on
but
that.
Were that the case? Is the IOC disappointed?
If it were the case, then I need to find out first before I commented for obvious
reasons.
Okay,
no hypotheticals. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll be seeing some of you later, but 568 ski facilities, so I was closer than you, Bobby, 568 ski facilities in China as we speak. Thank you very much. We will be here, and Robert, you, if you want to speak to Robert, he can give you a bit more detail. Thank you very much.